must be some kind of way out of here. Say the Joker to the thief. There's too much confusion. I can't get no relief. Businessman there, drink my wine. Plowman, dig my earth. None will level on the mine. Nobody of it is worth.
Hey, Benny, you outdid yourself once again, man. What a great song, especially when they're showing the San Quentin, right, Sean? When they're showing the San Quentin views, that song, man, that was outstanding.
Those are some old photos there.
Oh, yeah. Well, that man, that song is perfect for that. Did he pick that song, Benny, or did you pick the song?
I picked it. And you know, David, there's a photo where he's inside the electric chair. Mm-hmm. I think it's the electric chair. And he's in there with the hat, and that's a younger Art Calderon, you know. And he's in there with a couple of, I think it's maybe a news crew or somebody that's touring it. He is one of the black and white photos that first comes out.
So he wasn't a warden at that time, right, Benny?
Yeah, he was. I think he was. Yeah.
Well, was he? Wow, yeah. Man, that man, outstanding. With that said. With all that, you know what? Maybe at the end, I'll replay it again. We could see him. Hey, Benny, do you have any shout-outs?
No, I don't.
Big Sean, shout-outs?
No, I'm ready to jump into this.
Yeah, me too, man. Guys, prayers for Chalo. I guess last night he had a really bad earache, and he hasn't gotten any better. With that said, Matilde, we're going to be seeing you next month on the 30th up in Campbell at the Siglia Convention. We're looking forward to seeing you once again, sister. Fellow correctional officer and a legend with the Nebraska Department of Corrections. And we got the East Tennessee legend, San Diego, Doug Collier, with us. Guys, with that said, Benny, I'm going to hand it over to you. But before, I just want to read out some quick stats. I'm telling you guys, I'm excited about today's show. Art Calderon, this guy, we always talk about legends. Here's another legend. A man that, was one of the first guys assigned to, not the first, but the first group assigned to SSU, started his career in Tracy. And I know you're going to be covering all this, Benny. But let me just brief real quick our listeners. I know today's episode is executions in the state of California. Well, since 1883, there's been 514 executions by the state of California, 192 men by lethal injection at San Quentin, 4 women. Maybe Art could talk a little bit about that, by lethal injection. I believe at St. Quentin, 11 men by lethal injection. I'm sorry, the others were lethal gas. These are 11 men by lethal injection at St. Quentin. And I believe Art was part of 4. We'll talk about them. 92 men. Did you know that 92 men initially were hung at Folsom State Prison? There were hangings. That's how executed. I didn't know that. I was doing some research. Did you guys know that?
No.
They used to hang them in California. Did you know that, Benny?
No.
That's interesting. Yeah, 92 men by hanging in Folsom and 307 men by hanging at St. Quentin. And guys, yeah, that was very interesting. I did not know that. I'm sure Art is very familiar. We'll be talking about that. One last shout out, Ceci. We love you, sister. Thank you for always being there for us. Thank you very much. God bless you. And we have 408 SJ, I believe, is Sanjo. Yeah, Sanjo, checking in respect from Sanjo. With that said, Benny, it's all yours, brother.
You know, first of all, I want to thank all those people that work in San Quentin that are listening tonight.
Oh, yeah.
You know, we always get those, anytime we got Ayers or Calderon on, we get the people from San Quentin listening. So welcome to the show, guys, you know. So let's get started. I mean, Warden Art Calderon started his career as a correctional officer with the California Department of Corrections in 1966. Calderon held many ranks throughout his career, promoted to sergeant, lieutenant, captain, institutional parole agent in San Quentin, parole agent in San Jose, SSU special agent serving alongside many of the original SSU members, and assistant deputy. Director of Parole Division, was the chief deputy warden in Susanville, associate warden in the DBI, and was the warden in San Quentin, Tehachapi, CRC, and Norco, and retired in 1999. Now, when he retired in 1999, he was hired back to serve as a warden in Corcoran, Soledad, Salinas Valley, and Centinela State Prison. Warden Calderon also supervised four state order executions and witnessed an execution in Huntsville, Texas. Thanks for joining us again, Warden.
Thank you, Warden. Can you hear us?
Yes, yes. Thank you for having me. Again.
So, Warden, let's get started. Tonight's topic is state ordered executions. As Warden in St. Quentin, you enforce four court order executions. Can you tell us about those condemned men and who they were?
Yes. Let me put my cheaters on. I made some notes to myself here, so you'll have to excuse me for a bit. The first one that we executed was William George Bonin, commonly referred to as a freeway killer. He was convicted of 14 rape, robberies, and homicides of 14 teenage boys. Now, those are the ones that he was just convicted of. There was many, many more. Talking to district attorneys in the different areas around the, you know, L.A. and Long Beach, they're convinced that he did more. But, yeah, 14 horrible, horrible incidents. So he was executed on February the 23rd, 1996. He was, I don't know how far you want me to go into these things in terms of the last meals or the last words that he said, but he was the first one that I did by lethal injection at San Quentin.
Warden, do you mind telling us what his last meal was and his last words? If you have that information, that'd be interesting.
Yes, sure. For his last meal, Bonin received two large pepperoni and sausage pizzas, three pints of coffee, ice cream, and 3 6 packs of regular Coca-Cola. And I'll read verbatim what he told me as his last words prior to the execution. Quote, that I feel the death penalty is not an answer to the problems at hand, that I feel it sends a wrong message to the youth of the country. Young people act as they see other people acting instead of as people tell them to act. And I would suggest that when a person has a thought of doing something serious against the law, that before they did, that they should go to a quiet place and think about it seriously. Those were his last words to me.
I guess he forgot to go to a quiet place, huh, Warden?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. That's interesting. Okay. So, let's go with the next one, Warden. Very interesting.
The next one was executed on May 3rd, 1996. He was 17 years on condemned row at San Quentin. It was Keith Daniel Williams. He killed two men and a pregnant woman in a bizarre attempt to steal back a bad check he had written to one of his victims. The bodies of Miguel and Salvador Vargas were found laying face down on the floor of their Merced residence on October the 9th, 1978. Five days later, Lourdes Mesa's body was discovered in the field some distance from the residence. This hit home to me about the victims in that they were all farm workers. They didn't speak English. And it did some terrible, they were all terrible crimes, but especially this one to me it really hit home because I was raised up in the Central Valley working in the fields like these poor people. And what he did to that poor, especially that poor woman, it's just horrific, a horrific crime.
Hey, Warden, you were working for the Department of Corrections when this murder occurred, correct?
Oh, yes.
Do you remember vividly reading about it in the paper, watching the news about it?
Vaguely. I do remember. I wanted to speak a little bit about that one because that one really hit home for a lot of reasons. But I didn't know how you want to go with this. Do you want me to tell you about the last meal?
Yes. Last meal and also his last words, if you don't mind.
Right.
Well, he said William's last meal included fried pork chops, a baked potato with real butter, asparagus, salad with cheese dressing, apple pie, and a whole milk. He had no last words. When I asked him if he had any last words, he declined.
And Warden, who makes that last meal? Do you guys order it from a local restaurant or does your kitchen staff make that last meal?
Both. If we can do it in the kitchen, we would do that, some of that. But if not, we would order it out and have it delivered. Now, contrary to what some people may think that they can order anything. I mean, if somebody ordered lobster and ribeye, we're not going to do that, you know. But yeah. Within reason, we're going to go ahead and comply with his request.
If they wanted, let's say, a hamburger from, I'm just throwing this out, In-N-Out. And there was, back then there wasn't, but if there was, would you comply with something like that? If they wanted a hamburger from a certain Jack in the Box, for example?
Yes, that's reasonable. Yeah, we would do that. I'd send somebody to pick up the fries and hamburgers or whatever it wanted. Milkshake. Yeah, we would do that.
Wow, that's it. So no last words from this guy, huh?
No, I recall asking him in the death cell for his last word, but he said no, he had none. This guy, if I may, I'd like to go into this one a little bit more. As you probably heard, or maybe you haven't, I don't know. He, in preparation for the execution, the state says, So many people must be witnesses to the execution, including the victims' families, law enforcement from, in this case, Merced County, the district attorney's office, and then, of course, the media. Before these witnesses for the state come in, they usually start processing around, around 4 o'clock in the afternoon. We would bring that group up to the warden's residence there in San Quentin, and we would serve them a meal there at San Quentin. And we would, talk to the victims, trying to put them at ease. And in this particular case, these people, as I mentioned earlier, did not speak English. So my wife helped me tremendously, especially on this one, because she was able to bond with the families of these people. And it was a sorry state of affairs to see those poor people the way they were. But my wife was able to tone it down a little bit. We also provided psychological assistance. We had some of the prison psychologists and psychiatrists that would try to put them at ease. I mean, I know that law enforcement has seen a lot more horrific crimes than what you see with a sterile environment where you execute somebody and they see more. But still, it's this one is sort of a choreographed, planned kind of an execution. And this one right here on Williams, it really hit home with me. Because of the victims, only because of the victims. I don't feel nothing for the rest of them. So anyway, I thought I'd mention that. I can talk a little bit more about these things if you want later on.
Yeah. Warden, going back to that, so they actually had dinner at your home and your wife was the one that prepared the meal for them?
No. I used the prison staff. Oh, they prepared the meal. My wife was just the hostess. And I would go up there and meet and talk to the people. I mean, we've had the attorney general there, the Department of Corrections director. We had district attorneys from Merced County, the sheriff. We've had the sheriff from Orange County. And so we had a lot of people there. And again, because when we started, they came in at 4 o'clock and the execution wasn't scheduled until about 12. So, you know, we wanted to feed them and kind of put them at ease a little bit.
Well, that's very interesting. Okay, the next one, Warden.
Oh, yeah, I'm losing. The next one was Thompson. Thomas M. Thompson. He was executed July the 14th, 1998. He was 14 years, 1 month on death row. He was convicted of forcible rape and first-degree murder with a special circumstance of murder during the commission of rape for the 1981 murder of Ginger Fleischioli, 20, in Laguna Beach. His last meal included Alaskan king crab. I'll take back what I said about the lobsters. I've forgotten about this one. with melted butter, spinach salad, pork fried rice, Mandarin style spare ribs, a hot fudge sundae, and a six pack of Coca-Cola. His last words to me were, "For 17 years, the AG has been pursuing the wrong man. In time, he will come to know this. I don't want anyone to avenge my death. Instead, I want you to stop killing people. God bless." Those were his last words.
His last words. Interesting.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Then the next one, Warden.
The next one was... the next one was... I can't pronounce the name. Jeroen Sirpong.
Sirpongs.
Yeah. He was executed February the 9th, 1999, 15 years and 9 months on condemned row. Sirpong was a former Buddhist monk, was convicted of robbery, burglary, and 2 counts of first-degree murder in the December 15, 1981 death of Pekoven Pat Wattenborn and Quash Nguyen. The bodies of the men were found lying face down in a puddle of blood in the storage room of the Garden Grove Market where they were. Last meal, I don't have that information. He didn't have a last meal. Last words, he didn't want to have any last words. Interesting thing about him, he was, as I mentioned, he was a former Buddhist monk. Now, that was a first for me. Mm-hmm. I never expected to see that. And he had a spiritual advisor that was also a Buddhist monk prior to his execution. We would allow a spiritual advisor to come in and pray with these guys before they were executed.
There was a lot of controversy on that one, right, Warden? Because being a former Buddhist monk, and I think, Benny, if you could elaborate a little bit, Benny, what you were saying before the show about the protests and so forth. Do you mind just talking a little bit about that, Benny?
Well, Art, as we were talking about, there was a lot of demonstrations outside, you know, for and against on him. I think that you guys had to use resources from outside sources like the sheriff to come out and assist.
Yes. The Marin County Sheriff is very, very supportive and helpful. And they had the security outside the gate of San Quentin. In addition to the Sheriff's Department, we had the California Highway Patrol. We also had the Coast Guard, believe it or not, because we're right on the water. And so they would, you know, have a patrol boat up there if need be. But so, yeah, we had these support law enforcement folks that were really, really helpful to us.
Yeah. How bad was it that night? I mean, what was the atmosphere out there?
You know, it really wasn't bad. There was a little bit of shoving and pushing and going on, but nothing where you had to use gas or anything like that. We were a little concerned for a minute, but we also had our CERT, Special Emergency Response Team, right inside the gate. In fact, they were in one of the homes, garages in there, ready to assist with shields and gas and whatever else we needed. But we didn't have to utilize them. So, it got a little hectic for a little bit, but not too bad.
Yeah, Horton, how many times did they resent his execution? I think once or twice.
I don't have that information, but yeah, I think it was more than once. I think it was twice.
Yeah,
but that's not uncommon. We had people that were at the last minute. We were getting ready to execute them, and you know, a couple of hours before, and they had a stay. Usually it was the U.S. Supreme Court that gave the stay.
Mm-hmm. Hey, Warden, go ahead, Benny. Go ahead.
No, go ahead, David.
We watch movies. You know, I mean, the closest I could come to what you've done, what you've seen, is watching a movie. where they're getting ready to execute this individual, usually James Cagney movies from the 30s and the 40s, right? And they're getting ready to execute him, and all of a sudden that phone, is there a phone there that rings? And supposedly in the movies, James Cagney movies, it's the governor's phone. Is that real, or is it is? Okay.
Yes, we have a phone right there, right next to where I stand. And but we never used it at the last minute. Since the execution that I did, nobody called. We never had a stay. Like in the movies, it's usually at the last minute.
Yes.
But no, we never. I can recall one. We got to about 2 hours, I think, before the execution. But no, at the last minute phone call, no, we never received any.
And Warden, on that 2 hour call before the execution, everything is canceled. Everything stops. Everybody gets back in their cars. Everybody leaves. Inmate goes back to the waiting cell, or he goes back to his cell in death row.
Well, he goes back to the holding cell. Say he's already strapped into the gurney. He goes back for a while, and when things cool down a little bit, then they send him back to his assigned cell. We send him back.
And on that incident, that 2 hour incident, he was eventually executed. Was it months later, weeks later, or days later?
No, he wasn't. This one that I'm talking about was not executed. He's still around.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, that's interesting. Yeah. We have go ahead, Benny.
Tell us how stressful and hectic it is in the days before and after the execution. Just how crazy does it get down there?
Well, it really does. The phone doesn't stop ringing, and there is a considerable amount of stress, at least in my part, because I'm always trying to plan ahead the what ifs. And I can share a little something might be a little bit humorous right now, but it wasn't at the time. I had the director come in, and he was asking me, did I have a lot of stress? And he said, yeah. I said, well, I guess the stress comes from the inmates. I said, no, the stress comes from you guys in headquarters. They were calling me every 5 minutes, and you know, I'm trying to arrange this execution, assign people, prepare myself mentally. And so I told him that, and he looked at me kind of funny. And I said, you know what? You guys are calling me too often, you know, during the course of the day, and especially the hours leading up. And then we had a bunch of administrators coming in from headquarters that added to my stress. But there was some stress. I try to relieve myself, say about 6 in the evening. I would go to my house up there and talk to the victims' families that were already there, kind of relax a little bit before I went back to the office and start answering all those phones. But yeah, hey, Warden, it is stressful.
Warden, you have a comment from your brother, from Winzy Calderon, my carnalito Art. We are all very proud of him, from Shingletown, California. Shingletown, really, Shingletown.
Yeah, he ought to be cleaning up all the snow in his driveway. That's what he ought to be doing.
We also have a question from Angela Bernal, or Angel, Spencer. Angel Bernal, how many were already strapped to the gurney, then got a last-minute stay of execution during your watch, Warden?
None. All 4, we didn't get that far. No, none. The stays that we got was prior to them being strapped in, and in fact, prior to coming into the holding cell.
Hey, Warden, one more comment from Cynthia, your niece. Love you, Theo. Watching from Fort Bragg, your niece, Cindy Calderon. Okay. Go ahead, Benny or Sean.
Hey, Warden, let me ask you one more thing. I know you witnessed an execution in Huntsville, Texas. Mm-hmm. How different how different was it?
Oh, in Huntsville, they've executed so many people that it's kind of a routine to them. And you didn't see the media, at least I didn't while I was there. You didn't see, there were protesters, but very few, as I recall, maybe 20, where we had several hundred outside the East Gate of San Quentin when I was there. And in San Quentin, when I went, the warden at that time was a Warden Jones. He treated me, and I took a couple of my staff members with me because we wanted to prepare for the lethal injection. And very, very, he welcomed us to the institution. In fact, I went with him to the death house because they're not housed in Huntsville at the prison. They're housed in another prison, and they bring him in a couple of days before the execution. So I went with him to talk to the inmate, or the warden did. And so I went with him. I was standing there when, and this guy was a young guy, probably, I would say about 25 or so. And he had killed two kids during a robbery of a pawn shop that the parents owned. And the parents were, had gone out to dinner, and they were, they left them there to guard the store. And this guy came in and killed both of them during the process of robbing them. And this is, I think this is the only one that I've seen that we've executed that actually had tears. And I thought he was very remorseful when he was, I felt a little bit bad for him. But yeah, in his case, when they had the last, if he had any last words, he was strapped to the gurney with a speaker already on, or a microphone on top of the gurney where he could talk into it. And he cried all the time. And the chaplain was there and holding his hand and that kind of stuff. But it's a lot different. And they had a lot more executions, of course, in Texas than we did. And you didn't see the news media again and the people protesting outside. I can't say enough for the staff there at Huntsville, Texas. They treated us very, very well, and they welcomed us with open arms.
So go ahead, Big Sean.
Hey, Warden, we want to talk about the procedure or what happens when the individual is going to be put to death as ordered by the state. How is the execution team selected, and what do you look for when making your selection?
First of all, I select the people on the execution team at the time. I did it myself, but what I would look on the staff, first of all, I wanted people that were top notch, that were dependable, that knew how to keep their mouth shut, and that were loyal to the department, not to me, but loyal to the department. And I also did something different than maybe others would do. I asked the team if we had a vacancy for a new member. I asked the team for their input, but I let them know that I have 51% of the vote, but I wanted their input. And for the most part, they were all in favor. So I went ahead. But I didn't want any infighting. Say we got somebody that didn't belong there, or was shooting off his mouth or doing something unprofessional. We didn't want that. So the staff really helped me out. And I might add that any successes that I had is because of the excellent staff that I've had throughout my career. And these are no exception, the execution team. And we had a lieutenant was in charge of the execution team. A good man. I'm sorry, you asked me something else about the procedure. I'm sorry, I lost you.
Yeah, about the procedure, what happens when the individual is going to be put to death?
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. You get to be my age and your memory goes a little bit. But what happens is we get the order from the court. I take my litigation coordinator and maybe one other person, and we go up to condemn row, and I read him the order from the court. And we tell him he's going to be executed in the when, the words, and that kind of stuff, and what's expected of him. And I tell him very clearly that absent any stays by the Supreme Court, we're going to execute him. I said, now, I tell him, it's up to you how you want to go. You want to go as a man walking, and if need be, we'll drag you to the place. So it's up to you. But one way or another, you're going to be executed. But I wanted to be very, very clear with him, so there was no question later on that I never said that to him. Immediately after I do that, we put him on a suicide watch. We put an officer in front of his cell 24/7 to ensure that he doesn't cheat the justice. And then from there, that morning of the execution, I think around 9 o'clock, he's allowed to have visits all day long with his family or his attorneys or significant others. In the visiting room. So at about, I think it's 6 o'clock or so in the afternoon, maybe 5 or maybe a little early. I don't remember exactly. But I send one of my associate wardens over to tell him that the visiting is over. He kisses and hugs his relatives and they leave. And then we escort him up to the holding cell, the condemned cell up there, the death watch cell. We strip him out, put new clothing on him, and he's held there. And the only other person other than staff is the spiritual advisor in an adjoining cell that can stay with him until we bring him out to be executed on or about midnight.
Warden, do the majority of them have, I know that the monk had a monk there with him. The other three, did they have spiritual advisors? Were they Catholic? Were they pastors? Were they chaplains? Do you remember?
No, I know Serapong because it was something different, you know, the Buddhist monk. But the other ones, I tell you the truth, I don't remember. I don't remember. I think on Bonin, we didn't have one because this thing about the spiritual advisor came after, and I'm not sure if we had him, to tell you the truth. I don't remember. It's been 20 years or so or more.
Bobby Hernandez, a mutual friend of ours, mentioned, I guess, that he was part of that one of the that group that organized the team, the death squad team, or I'm not sure, execution team. Let's call it the execution team. But he's mentioned that there's one chaplain that is very popular there at St. Quentin, African-American chaplain. He also, I believe, works for the 49ers. He said that he would walk the tiers there at death row, and that he provided a lot of spiritual counseling to a lot of these individuals. Do you remember that chaplain? That I'm sure there's a lot of chaplains, but the one that Mr. Hernandez has described?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely. That's Earl Smith. And I wasn't going to mention Bobby's name, but yeah, Bobby was actually my right hand man, has been for many years. So yeah, but like I said, I wasn't going to mention Bobby's name, but since he already told you, that's fine.
Yeah,
with me.
He told.
But Earl Smith, yeah, Earl Smith would go up there and pass out Bibles, literature, talk to the inmates, that kind of stuff. So he was kind of a calming influence on the inmates for the most part.
Go ahead, Benny.
So, Warden, those people that are selected, are they, is it kept quiet around among the rest of the employees as who's on the execution team? How does that work? I mean, after the execution, are they known? Are they revealed? Do the inmates know?
Well, no, we never publicly, we don't announce that ever. But you know how things are. They get out. I'm sure they get out. But we meaning myself and the staff, we never let it out. Another thing I should mention, after the execution and the body's taken out in the mortuary and that kind of stuff, anything calms down, everybody's out, then we meet either in my house in the warden's residence or some other residence in the house just to calm down a little bit and critique to make sure that everything went according to plan. But we don't put out the information on the names, but I'm sure they get out. The names get out.
Yeah. So who witnesses the execution? Who selects those witnesses, and how are they selected?
Well, the ones that I recall, the county, say, for example, on William's execution, Merced County, they had the sheriff and district attorney, and we had two others that are selected by the sheriff and the district attorney, as I recall. We also have, they call them official witnesses. The state law says that we will have, I think it was 12 official witnesses. I selected some of those, and the department would approve. And I recall I selected one of them was the chief of police at the time from San Rafael, and others that we selected. So, but yeah, the law is very clear in terms of the witnesses that are allowed. Like I said, there's 12 official witnesses, but there's also the witnesses of the people, the person being executed that are there. And sometimes he has, I don't know, a wife. He also has his attorneys there and maybe a brothers or sisters. I think there's six of those, and I don't remember the exact number.
Are the witnesses warned or told about what kind of etiquette should take place while they're there?
Oh, yeah, no. Yeah, sure. I made sure of that, and whether they're law enforcement or not. And when we get the people, for example, the district attorney, of the county, for example, Merced, the sheriff, and other law enforcement staff, and others in the community that I was mentioning, the chief, I meet with them right before the execution around 11 in a room close to where the execution is going to take place. And I go there and in no uncertain terms, and I tell them that I will not tolerate any disruptions, that the first one that raises hell, that I'm going to have him escorted. And they agreed. And then a lieutenant or one of my associate wardens tells the family of the person being executed and the others. I don't go with them because you can imagine I'm the warden and I'm not going to go over there with the families of the ones that I'm being executed. So I send them and they basically tell them the same thing, that we will not tolerate any nonsense, any outburst of any kind, anything that we'll escort them out. And they're not allowed to take anything with them except like the press. I forgot to mention the press is also part by law. They have to be there, a pencil and a notepad, and that's all they have with them when they go in there. But yeah, interestingly, the sheriff of Merced County wrote a nice letter to the institution and to me about his experience during the Williams execution. And he clearly, you know, mentions that part where I go in there and I tell him in no uncertain terms what's expected of them.
Warden, before the next question, we have two questions from our listeners. One of them, Narco Dogs, welcome to the show, brother. Is it a doctor who administers the fatal injection, or is the injection controlled by the execution team? Good question.
The actual injection is done by a member of the execution team.
Okay. The next question by Jeronimo de los Cielos, another great brother from Arizona. Did any executions ever show wrong guy executed on forensics? Are you aware of any?
No, I'm not.
No.
I should say that most of them all claim they're innocent anyway.
Yes.
So you know how that goes.
Most definitely.
I forgot to mention too that no doctor administers it. One of my execution team members does that. I was going to do it. I was going to take that responsibility, but I was under orders from headquarters for me not to do it because they wanted my full focus on the whole procedure and not be distracted by actually doing the injection. Also, I should mention that we had a monitor, and I kept looking for the monitor. You know, the straight line. And that's what I was hoping for real quick, because you know how it goes up and down. I forget what they call that line. And so once a straight line, that means that the guy is dead. And so there was a doctor that pronounced him dead at that point, usually in about 8 to 10 minutes. And I should mention that you hear a lot about, oh, how they suffer and all the pain and on and on. I can tell you the 5 executions that I've been a part of, that I've witnessed, I didn't see any pain. What I see is like a color purple, kind of purplish, that turns in their face, but in terms of any pain, no, I didn't see that. Whoever's saying that, they must have been in another execution, because I never witnessed that.
Warden, I have a question. That you mentioned that there's one person that administers the fatal dose. Is there like 3 individuals that have, and one of them has a real dose that inject the fatal dose, or that one person knows that he or she was responsible?
Yeah, one person. We don't have 2 or 3. We have one person, and that person is standing right next to him. And I give him the order when to commence the injection.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Hey, Warden, do you select that person, or does that person select it by the group?
Nope, that one I selected myself.
Okay. Next question.
Hey, Warden, how much preparation takes place before and on the day after the execution?
Yeah, we do. Once we know that an execution is pending, say within the next month or so, we accelerate the training program. We have our execution team go through the process, planning for any eventuality, any hiccups, so to speak, that might come up. We do dry runs. I take part in them. Myself and we go and observe our execution team. We also act, one of the staff members acting out in case the person that's going to be executed is going to fight us. So we have a good actors, and we had one in particular. I'm not going to tell you the name, but he put on they fought him all the way from the death cell to the execution chamber. So yeah, we do a lot of planning, but we usually start that probably a month or so before the actual execution, the training of the staff, to make sure that we're sharp, that we take care of business, that we plan for any eventuality. So that happens. So we do. There is a lot of planning. Then we meet, of course, with the outside agencies, the sheriff's department, the police department, San Rafael, CHP, that kind of stuff. Yeah.
And those agencies that leads into my next question. Are those agencies are there to prepare for demonstrations or any other type of events or incidents that might occur outside the prison system?
Yes, they control everything that happens outside the gates of the prison. But we coordinate with them, and they're there to ensure that it doesn't disrupt the execution or that there's a riot or any of those kinds of things. So they're really, really very good. The Marin County Sheriff's very, very efficient organization.
Hey, Sean, go ahead and go with the next one because he pretty much covered one I was going to ask.
Jay, you want me to go to number 8?
Yes.
Okay. How does the prison population act or behave the days before and on the day of an execution?
Great question.
We generally put them on lockdown the day before and the day after. And but no incident, a quiet, normal operation, no problem, none whatsoever. They're well behaved as they can be, and we didn't have any problems.
What do you mean by lockdown? Is the entire facility gets locked down? No yard, nothing, everything shut down?
Yes, we lock it down for the day before and the day after, and then we release them.
Oh, wow.
Now, if there was a problem, then we wouldn't release them, obviously. But yeah, we keep them locked down.
Mm-hmm. Warden, 3 quick questions. One of the questions for Ruben. Ruben Nava is a retired, another great legend. He's going to be our guest next week. But he's asking, he's a retired detective sergeant with the Los Angeles Sheriff's Department, but mm-hmm. he's also a chaplain. He says in 2023 horror film, Nefarious, about a death row inmate who claims to be possessed by a demon, and is a great movie. Just FYI, has that ever happened? Maybe not the 5 individuals that you saw, but have you heard any stories like that where somebody basically claims and acts possessed?
Well, if anybody was possessed, it was Richard Ramirez, as far as I'm concerned. Now, I'm not saying he was the only one.
Yeah, but
that guy right there, you can see the devil in that boy. You look in his eyes, and I'd walk the tears, and I'd look at this guy, and you recall, you may not recall, but when he was going through his court hearing, he did the what is that devil sign, the star, the
hexagram, the devil
yeah, that one, and he had it in his hand. And in fact, when they were taking him out after he was sentenced, he said something about "Hail Satan." Now that guy was possessed, as far as I'm concerned. Now, I'm not saying he's not the only one, but that one right there. You know, I thought about that one. Yeah.
Warden, I have a quick question. These individuals that you saw, these 5 individuals, were not members of any prison gang. Has any prison gang member in the state of California that you're aware of ever been executed? That's my first question. If there is, I have a follow-up that you're aware of.
Yeah, the one after I retired that was definitely involved in the gangs or the Crips was Tukey Williams.
He was a heavy in that gang.
The ones that I did, to my knowledge, no, they, those guys weren't involved in any prison gang, but Williams was. But that was after I retired; they executed him.
And after he was, because he was, I guess, one of the founders of the Crips. Did you see a rise in violence in the state of California by the Crips or by BGF after his death that you're aware of, Warden? I know you were retired.
No, that I'm aware or not. And I was still working, as you mentioned earlier, as an annuitant working in the different prisons. But no, I didn't see an uptick on the violence at all because of that.
Perfect. Go ahead, Big Sean.
I think I'll just stop because he's already answered number 9. So I'll just go to number 10. Warden, is the body released to the family, and what happens after the execution order is carried out?
After the execution, then my staff removes all the witnesses. Everybody's escorted out of the execution chamber, and they go on their way. Then the execution team unstraps the guy from the gurney and puts him in a body bag. Well, first of all, takes his clothes off and puts him in a body bag, but they take his fingerprints. They print the guy. They take his fingerprints. They zip up the bag, and the mortuary backs up into the area there, and they load him up, and he's gone. Now, if the family can claim the body from the mortuary, if they want now, if he doesn't have any family and nobody claimed, then the county will bury him, at the expense of the county. But in essence, that's what happens.
Warden, very interesting. If anybody else has any questions of our listeners, please type your questions. Meanwhile, Warden, I have the last, that was our last question related to the subject matter. I have one that's not related to the subject matter, but I think you might be able to answer. I don't know the year, but I do know that this brutal fight happened in front of your house. And it was Mosca. I don't know if Mosca was a member of the M and Rudy the Brute. Tell us about that big incident that happened there on prison grounds in front of your house. And I think you know who asked me to ask you this question.
You know what? I know I'm getting up in years, but at that particular in front, you mean in front of the warden's house?
Yeah, you were the warden there, and Rudy the Brute showed up, and then Mosca, and they had a pretty vicious fight there in front of your house. Do you remember that?
No, I really don't. I lived there for 5 years. I really don't remember that one. Now, there was a Mosca that was killed in the South Block, in the showers that I knew, but that fight, that never happened while I was there. I certainly would have known that. Plus, my wife would have snitched everybody off.
I think Bobby meant your dog Mosca and his dog.
I'm sorry. My head is somewhere else. Yeah. Oh, Bobby. Well, I can tell you real quickly. Yeah, they had this big old Rudy the Brute dog, and he attacked my little old dog that weighed about 3 pounds, tore him apart, and we were in there trying to separate him, and Bobby's daughter was trying to separate him. I was trying to separate him, and the captain lived across the street from me. He came to help, and finally we got my poor dog until Bobby came, and I said, let's take him real quick to the vet.
Yeah.
So while we were at the vet said, okay, well, we're going to have to keep him, and you're going to have to come up with $550 or something like that. Uh-huh. And Bobby looked at me. I said, don't look at me. He said, it was your dog. You're paying for it. And he gave me the old I left my wallet at home trick. He said he didn't have a credit card. I said, well, go get it, and I'll stay here until you get it because I ain't paying no $550. So, yeah, he attacked my dog. So, yeah, I'm sorry. My head was somewhere else. Yeah.
Yeah, he asked me. I talked to him earlier today, and he goes, hey, man, please. I go, dude, we have a serious subject matter tonight. He goes, ask him at the end. So he wanted me to ask you, and he was laughing. We were laughing about it. But with that said, your son Arturo has a really good question. It says, wasn't there an old graveyard on the San Quentin property? Can you talk about that?
Yeah, it's still there. It's up in the mountain. The one that does a real good job describing all of that, Pobrecito, I mean, he's dead now. He deceased. It's Dick Nelson. It's associate warden, a historian, knew all about San Quentin. He worked at Folsom and San Quentin. He was associate warden, worked for me. He worked, I think, 40 years or something like that in the department. But he speaks to that in his book, if you've never read it. It's by Bill Hankins. Yeah, they have up above the hills, above San Quentin, it's still prison property. I forget how many tombstones or how many buried people are up there, inmates. They were never claimed, and so the state buried them up there. So they're still there.
Well, and are they still burying people there, Warden, that you're aware of?
No, that ended, I think, probably in the late 50s or thereabout, before I even started in the department. Mm-hmm. No, they don't. Now if they die, and again, they turn the bodies to the family, including the general population inmates, and the mortuary then turns them over to the family. So, no, they don't bury, bury people there anymore.
Hey, Benny, we have a comment by Ruben Nava. He'll be with us next week, the detective sergeant from LASO. Maybe he can talk about, we'll add this question to his questions next week regarding Richard Ramirez at the LA County Jail. I guess he knew him there. So we'll add that to the questions. Warden, it was an honor. It truly was. And we one of the reasons why we started this show, all four of us, was to bring back these stories. To not let these stories die, to hear people like yourself tell us these stories so your grandchildren, your nieces, my grandchildren can see this and always remember that, you know what, it was men like you and staff that you had that propelled us where we're at today. Me as a Latino, I am grateful to your brother, Vicente, who started the LPOA. I am grateful to men like you that opened the path for me to go as high as I wanted to be with the department. It was men like you that paved the way. We're very grateful, and thank you, Warden.
If I may, I once again, I want to give a shout out to the to the Department of Corrections staff, especially those that work in San Quentin. It's an old prison with a lot of maintenance needs and problems. But as I mentioned to everyone, any accomplishments I ever had in my career was because of the staff that worked for me. And I'll never forget them. We mentioned the other day when we were talking about there's always that old 5% that I call the old 5% that gave me some grief. But now I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer. But when you surround yourself with sharp people that are going to take care of you, they're the ones that make things happen. And not the warden. It's not the warden that does that. It's the people that are out there on the yards and the cell blocks doing these jobs. It's not me. It's them.
Thank you, Warden. Benny, any last words for Warden Calderon?
Oh, not last words, but I was going to ask you about the little eerie place in San Quentin that David and I had the privilege and the approval to go in, because apparently nobody's allowed in there now unless you're, I guess, special, you know. And David and I were out there, and we were allowed to go in. I'm talking about the dungeon. Mm-hmm. What's the story? I mean, you know, it's an eerie place.
Oh, no, and I didn't go there but a few times myself, and I certainly didn't go for myself and at night. But yeah, it is, and I'm not into all those ghosts and all that. But yeah, it's a little bit scary when you go into that place. And so I don't know all the history and details. I'm not the historian. Dick Nelson, if you were around, he knew all the story. And then there's others that know the story behind all those. But no, I know what you're talking about. I've been there several times.
Was that the only dungeon, or is that the only one left for historical purposes?
Well, they had the one in the captain's porch. They call it the captain's porch down there. And then they had the other one as you're going down to the, I know you haven't been there, but then the lower yard, as you go on the left-hand side in there, the actual cells are there. They don't have the doors anymore, but they have the cell itself.
That's the one we went in, Warden. That's right. The one we went in. Is there another one that is worse than that one?
Well, I think so.
That, really?
Okay. I mean, and they do. They I don't know what they do with it now, but there was some old stuff that was stored down there at that place as well. Also in this other place that you're talking about. But yeah.
That's the one we went to, Benny, the one by the lower yard.
Yeah, I'm telling you, it's an eerie place. I went all the way to the back and into one of the, because it's like, it's a dungeon, but there's like caves. I call them caves because that's what they look like.
Old cells.
Yeah, they're old cells, and they go deep, and they're dark, and they smell kind of musty, and it's just a lot of stories that I've heard, you know. And like I said, it was quite an experience to go in there, and they had the chance to go in.
Well, can you imagine when we used to lock them in those days? Lock them up in there. They didn't even have a toilet. They used a honey bucket. And they could put four or five inmates. They didn't care how many went in that cell, and they stayed there for months.
Yeah, no electricity.
And there was no air conditioning, right?
Oh no.
Or heaters.
No, nothing like that.
Yeah. Big Sean, any last words for Warden Calderon?
Yeah, thank you, Warden, for the history lesson. It's some of the stories are absolutely amazing. You know, we deal with it in the street, but you deal with them all locked up.
Yeah. I just want to remind the folks that are listening that's I forget a little bit because it's been 20 years plus, and it's amazing how time flies, but I still have a lot of material. In fact, I was telling Benny about some of the stuff that he didn't see the last time that he was here. So maybe later on you can go through them if you want, Benny, and check it out.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, going through Arch House is like going through a museum of San Quentin. I mean, I was just like, wow, I mean, this is really awesome, you know?
Yeah.
Warden, there's a last question by Jeronimo de los Cielos, one of our faithful listeners from Arizona. Did the death chamber get disassembled in California? It's funny that he asked that question. I was just reading Bobby today send me an article about the death chamber, also about death row. I guess that by the summer, death row, all the inmates are going to be completely sent to other prisons. There will no longer be a death row, correct, Warden? I don't know if you read that article. He sent it to me today. I'm sure he sent it to you also.
Yes.
But he's talking about that all these death row inmates were 700 and something. I don't have the numbers here. Are now at Corcoran, Tehachapi, all the level 4 prisons. but there's only a few left. I believe the Ayala brothers and a couple there at St. Quentin. Yes. They're getting ready to get dispersed to state prisons, mm-hmm. and they're going to convert death row into one-man cells, or it's going to be part of the Norway project. Did you hear anything about that, Warden?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we talked about the Norway project.
Yeah, we did, yes.
I was gonna mention it's long overdue. When I was a warden there, we submitted some paperwork to relocate the condemned to other institutions. But I knew in my heart of hearts that it wasn't going to be done because politics entered it. You know, the community, and rightly so, they don't know anything about prisons. And the first thing they were start yelling about, oh my God, we got 100 death row inmates over here in our prison. And I knew it wasn't going to happen, but we submitted it, and it was never approved to move them. San Quentin is an old, beat-up place. That place should have been closed down 30, 40, 50 years ago. And to have the inmates, it required a lot of man hours. The officers had to climb up five tiers when they were over in the east block to feed them. They fed them in their cells. It's just a terrible situation. And so, and you know, I don't think there's ever going to be another execution, quite frankly. I'm pro-execution, don't get me wrong. But I don't think, given the way things are, that we're going to have another execution. So yeah, put them in another prison. Most of those people on death row, they're not going to give you a problem. But those people that you're mentioning, the Ayala brothers and those yes. other type of inmates, those people need to be locked up for the rest of their lives. But the other ones, you can put them out and give them more freedom. They do that in other states. Texas is an example. Mm-hmm. I don't have any problem doing that. But this rehabilitation program that they're talking about for San Quentin, well, I wish them well, but like I mentioned the last time, if they don't monitor it and they don't keep tabs on it, it's not going to work. I'm convinced of that because I've seen too much. I'm for real reasonable rehabilitation program. But when you're talking about spending, what, $360 million to rehab San Quentin, I have a problem as a taxpayer. I have a problem with that.
Yeah, most definitely.
Hey, Warden, you see St. Quentin as becoming another Alcatraz, like a tourist attraction once they shut it down?
I can see that because there's a lot of interest. I when I was a warden there, we had people from all over the world. You'd think they were coming to Disneyland. And there were people from Japan, from Australia, from England, from you name it, coming to see San Quentin. Of course, San Quentin is the oldest prison in the state since 1852, even older than Folsom. And I would imagine so. I would imagine they could sell tickets to go see that place if it ever closes down. But I don't know if it'll ever happen. But there's a lot of interest in that place.
Oh, that would be interesting. Well, Warden, once again, thank you very much. You got to promise us you're going to come back. I mean, we're going to find 10, 20 topics, but you're coming back, man. We love having you on our show. And don't forget to get back at Bobby for Mosca and the Big Brute.
Oh, Bobby owes me. Bobby owes me, man.
That's right. All right. Hey, Warden, thank you.
It's an honor to speak to you guys. Thank you.
Thank you. God bless you, Warden.
God bless you, too.
Give our best to your family.
Thank you.
Wow. What a story down he shared with us in history, huh?
Yeah. Oh, dude, that place, I mean, if those walls could talk.
Yeah.
You know, imagine the stories they could tell.
Yeah.
Hey, here we got Warden, another great legend, Warden Ayers. Richard Ramirez was the only one I can remember that gave me the creeps. To give Warden Ayers the creeps, he must have been a real monster, which we all know. Yeah. Wow. Yeah, Warden Ayers, another legend, man. Watch, we got to get him back too. Benny,
I know that I would not like to sit across the desk getting disciplined by the Warden Ayers, man.
Oh, yeah.
or Warden Calderon. I mean, Warden,
Six,
6'3". Oh, yeah. I mean, these guys, I mean, that's why they were wardens. You know what I mean? Yeah. They're legends. And, you know, we were talking when Warden Ayers was on the show, I think you were on the call or on the debriefing after the show, Sean, we were saying that Warden Ayers, when you see Warden Ayers, you see Warden Calderon, these are like the Daryl Gates of LAPD. I mean, these are legends, you know what I mean, within the Department of Correction. It was during Warden Ayers when he was giving us the 10 what were deadly sins a warden can make. Yeah. I mean, it was like, it's just like if Bill Collender from San Diego PD, Sheriff John Duffy, from the sheriffs. I mean, these are all legends. If they were on our show talking, I mean, these guys, hey, Warden Ayers, Warden Calderon, and so many others. I mean, these guys are legends. Benny,
yeah,
I want to
commend you.
They're from that generation. Yeah. The last generation. And Benny, I want to commend you, man, for bringing these men and women, and women on board. We got to start getting some more women on board, too, with more women. But, guys, with that said, Benny, I know you're going to talk about next week's guest. But before you do, let me talk about tomorrow. Tomorrow we have Ash Wednesday, and we have a special guest who's going to be – it's just funny that before we get a guest, I have him on Ash Wednesday. I prepare him for you. I get him liquored up with some tequila or with some moonshine. You're the one with the moonshine. I get him liquored up a little bit, so get him ready, because last week we had Ruben Nava. My God. I mean, at the end of the show, both Bobby and I were like, well, our mouths wide open. This guy, I mean, what a legend. He's a humble man, doesn't like to be called a legend. But the things that guy did and what he's doing today, but I'm not going to ruin it because you're going to talk about him for next week. But before you do, tomorrow we have Saul Ayala. Saul Ayala is a retired detective with the Phoenix Police Department. He literally holds the record for the most undercover buys in Phoenix PD. This guy was buying kilos of cocaine, was buying tons of marijuana. Literally, this guy looks like a gangster, talks like a Mexican cartel. And the funny thing is, he retired several years ago, but he's still working undercover today on several federal task forces. That's all I could say. So tomorrow when he's on a show, he smokes cigars. He's going to be smoking a cigar with a mask on. He's going to be another mundo because he can't show his face. You know what I mean? Yeah. But tomorrow he's going to be on our show. If you guys are bored tomorrow, you want to have a Camel Day midweek drink. Join us at 5 o'clock Pacific Standard Time on this channel. But the show is called Ash Wednesday. We have an undercover cop who's going to be masked up because he's still doing undercover work. He's been retired for several years. Older gentleman as myself, he's going to be on our show and he's going to be talking about some of the cases that he worked. But Benny, I know he's going to be on our show on the Great Line in a couple of weeks. So he's not going to talk about his shooting where he got shot. So we're going to leave all that for our show. But tomorrow he's going to have a drink, smoke a cigar, and talk about some of his undercover work and then continue on the Great Line in 3 weeks. Yeah. So I'm excited. It's going to be a good show.
I was going to mention that shot in the line of duty.
Yeah. Oh, that's going to be, I'm not even going to touch it. Me and Bobby Arce are not even going to touch it tomorrow. But tomorrow we're going to have a good drink, smoke a cigar. And we're going to talk about some of the challenges, some of the cases that he worked, but we're going to leave the shooting for the Gray Line. With that said, Benny, tell us about next week's guest, or if you have anything else.
Well, we have retired LA Sheriff Detective Sergeant Ruben Nava, as you mentioned. You know, he was part of Operation Safe Streets, OSS. We're going to talk about some of those gang cases and how LASO handles gang violence in their jurisdictions, because they have a lot of jurisdictions within LA County. Sergeant Nava will tell us about the violence level caused by a lot of the street gangs in LA. So it's going to be pretty interesting. And not only that, we got the following week,
Roger Demchak, is it? Roger Demchak, or I think we have Saul. Saul Ayala, right?
Roger. Let me look real quick here, because it's pretty interesting. We got after Ruben Nava, we have Hector Bravo.
On the Thursday night show,
And he's going to be talking about the 10 deadly errors of a correctional officer. That is going to be very interesting, especially with everything going on in the Department of Corrections now and the Norway Project and all the stuff going on. You know, it's going to be pretty interesting on how to keep your guard up, working among some of America's most violent men.
Perfect.
Cool.
You want to give us, Sean, go ahead and give us your last words.
Again, just with everything that's going around, and a quick shout out to I failed to mention this earlier, to the team that are working, the crews that are working the Baltimore bridge, the bridge that was struck this morning. That, you know, that's a hell of a job to do right now, especially with that cold water and looking for victims and that road crew that was up on top. But with everything else, keep your head on a swivel. And yeah, just be safe.
Big Benny, your last words?
Just hey guys, just be smart about what you do. You know, whatever that backup camera, that camera helps you, but it also screws you over. And remember, it's Monday night quarterback by many. Your split second decision is going to get quarterback by the media, the administrators, your partners. So just do the right thing and stay alert.
Remember, live a purpose-driven life. Live every day like it's your last day on earth. Make a difference in somebody's life. You don't need a badge. You don't need a uniform. Whether you're a cop or an ex-con or a doctor or a nurse, it doesn't matter. Make a difference in somebody's life. Next time you're at the grocery store and there's an old lady or an old man right behind you and you feel in your heart a tug to pay for the groceries, pay for the groceries. And you're going to see how God is going to bless you more than ever. Nobody will ever know that you paid for that old lady's groceries or that young man's groceries, a young lady's groceries. Nobody will ever know. But because you did something to help somebody, believe me, the more you give, the more you receive. And the last words are, remember to give without expecting nothing in return. If you don't give, don't expect to receive. You give without expecting nothing in return, you will be blessed that you cannot believe. I am a testament of that. The more you give, the more you receive. Live a purpose-driven life. God bless you. We will see you tomorrow on Ash Wednesday. Thank you.